Recorded Books and RB Digital present Snapshot by Camryn King, narrated by Lynnette R. Freeman. Chapter 1. The Bahamas. Sun and sea. Gentle breezes. Tasty drinks with floating umbrellas. Paradise. Kennedy Wade thought about the refreshing drink brought by the kind boat captain as she placed her foot on the boat's gunwale and braced herself against the boat's gentle rocking to snap a round of pics. She was relieved that the showers from that morning had passed over the island, leaving behind fluffy cumulus clouds floating in a bright blue sky. She looked forward to enjoying her last day on the water, as she'd intended. For the past 2 days, she'd crisscrossed the island, documenting its beauty and writing up the accompanying article for a spread set to appear in the Chicago Star's newspaper's upcoming Memorial Holiday Sunday edition. But today was for her. As she took in the beauty of the Caribbean, with its pristine white beaches, turquoise waters, and verdant countryside, a rare philosophical thought assailed her. Kennedy wasn't necessarily religious and had no real concept of heaven or hell, but if for whatever reason she landed in the latter, at least she would have caught a glimpse of paradise.
"What are you doing, girl? You're supposed to be relaxing."
Kennedy smiled. Clinton's lyrical phrases drifted toward her on the wings of the wind. The boat captain had helped make the time pleasurable during her 10 to 12 hour workdays. He regaled her with colorful stories about famous people who'd visited the island and engaged in shenanigans they hoped would stay there, just like Vegas. She lowered the camera. "Taking pictures like this is relaxing. Not like the other days, while waiting for the right light or searching for the perfect shot, then returning to her room to spend another few hours crafting the words that would bring the reader fully into this idyllic world. Today, I can just take in the beauty and capture the magic when it happens." She looked beyond Clinton and motioned with a nod of her head. "Like that." Raising her camera, Kennedy placed the colorful lines of a perfect rainbow squarely in the middle of her lens. She adjusted her aperture to enhance the color, then engaged her long-range lens for a clearer shot. She took several frames, pulled out a bit to include a small island, and shot a few more. Her finger hovered over the shutter when a flash caught her eye. What was that? Instinctively, she pushed the shutter in rapid succession before lowering the camera, squinting as she shielded her eyes from the sun. They were a good distance away from the island, which was dense with brush and tropical trees. She looked for Clinton, who'd returned to the helm, then back at the rainbow. It had shifted and begun to fade. She joined the captain up front. "These smaller islands all around, are they inhabited?"
"Some of them, but not these out here."
"Are you sure?" She nodded toward the rainbow, now behind them. "What about that one, directly in front of the rainbow?"
"Someone owns it, but as of right now, it's uninhabited."
"I could have sworn I saw a flash while taking pictures."
"It could be anything," Clinton said. "Most likely, something reflecting against the sun."
"Like what?" The captain shrugged as he waved to a tourist boat passing by.
"We've had hundreds of years for all kinds of things to have washed up on these shores."
"That makes sense." Kennedy spent the better part of an hour photographing the beauty that surrounded her. Satisfied, she sat on a bench facing the water and rested her head back to look at the sky. "This is the life right here, my friend. You are so lucky to call this home."
"Easy enough for you to do, too, if you want it. Plenty of people want their picture taken. could set up a little stand on the beach, get a printer, make it work.
You make it sound so easy.
Everything's easy in the Bahamas.
Probably true, Kennedy imagined.
Not like back in Chicago, where freelance photographers and writers outnumbered White Sox fans, making both industries dog-eat-dog. Or where she'd just unraveled herself from a complicated relationship that had continued long past its expiration date. Even in paradise, there was no escaping serial liar slash cheater Will's incessant texts begging to be given one more chance. She'd blocked his number, but he'd only used a friend's phone or bought burners to continue his pleas. It would be a hassle to change a number she'd had for more than a decade, but maybe that time had come. Because after too many chances to count, Kennedy was done with the brother named Will. Done with him, and for the moment, done with thinking about him. She reached for the decadent rum punch she'd saved for this moment, settled herself against the bench's far side, stretched her legs out, and allowed the water to rock away the stress of the past few days. She thought of her friend Gwen, who worked in advertising for the Star, and had given her the inside info that led to this plum assignment, and her being rocked like a baby in the ocean's arms. She needed to find a gift of thanks before leaving the island. Wake up, sleeping beauty. It's time to go ashore.
I want to sleep? Kennedy blinked her eyes against the setting sun as she righted herself on the bench, and accepted Clinton's outstretched hand. I can't believe I was that tired.
You've been working hard, lady.
I know. But still, I plan to see more on the return trip than the back of my eyelids.
Plus,
he added, with a nod toward the empty glass that was set on a table.
You were sipping at sea, and you know what they say.
No, what do they say?
Bahama rum packs a punch.
Said with such infectious glee, and in that rhythmic accent, Kennedy joined Clinton in laughing out loud. While doing so, she noted his pristine white teeth, the dimple peeking through a 5 o'clock shadow, and the cute little crinkles surrounding his sparkling onyx eyes. To make sure she was healed from Will, she'd sworn off casual dalliances and one-night stands. Was she sure that extracurricular was out? His voice dropped an octave as he added,
and rum is not the only thing packing.
One thought kept Kennedy's resistance from breaking. That same type of package is what had kept Will in her life for 2 years, a year, 10 months, and 2 days longer than he should have stayed. Yes. She was sure. Your offer is tempting, she replied with a smile to not leave his ego bruised. Then reached inside her pouch and pulled out a tip. He raised his hands.
Oh, no, that's not necessary. Beautiful lady, squiring you around was my pleasure.
And mine, too. Especially since you arranged for me to be your only passenger. That cost you sales.
Not really.
Clinton glanced at Kennedy and continued a bit sheepishly.
Today was my off day, so your loan fare is more than what I would have normally made.
Clinton, you shouldn't have used your free day for me.
Like I said, it was my pleasure.
While appreciating the obvious flirtation from the Caribbean cutie, Kennedy knew the teasing was as far as she'd go. She reached into her purse again and pulled out another bill to add to the one in her hand. I'm greatly appreciative. It was a wonderful ride. She held out the money. I insist.
Okay, beautiful lady. Thank you.
They stepped on to the landing. Kennedy hugged Clinton, allowed him a selfie, and took one of her own. Then strolled down the ramp to a line of awaiting taxis. Feeling the captain's manly muscles reminded her how long it had been since one had been inside her. It heightened her awareness of the island men's looks. Suddenly, they were all gorgeous, including the dark chocolate bar who smiled and opened his cab door so she could slide inside. Must be that packing punch room. The hotel was only 5 minutes away. On the ride there, she planned out the rest of her evening. Order room service, do a final read-through of her article before sending it off to the travel section editor, upload photos to her cloud accounts, enjoy an 8-plus-hour date with her pillow. She entered the lobby and walked over to the concierge.
Hello, Hank. Hello, Kennedy. How are you today?
Deliciously tired. I spent the day on a boat.
Ah, the water. A great lover.
The best. A perfect way to enjoy my last day here.
Leaving so soon? You only arrived.
I feel that way too. I'll be back. And staying with us, I hope. Most likely. You guys are amazing.
What can I do for you this evening?
Recommend something great from the room service menu or a restaurant nearby that delivers?
Hank looked aghast. On your last night in paradise? Oh, no, my lovely lady. You mustn't spend this last night all alone in your room. At the very least, you should enjoy a delicious meal and glass of wine while taking in a view of all that you're leaving. I know just the place to recommend. Only a short 5-minute walk from our front door.
I'm exhausted, but your suggestion is hard to resist.
You won't be sorry. I promise you.
Kennedy watched as Hank pulled a card from several stacks on his station. She accepted it, gave a wave, and headed to her room. After checking off the items on the evening's to-do list, all except the pillow date, she took a quick shower and donned a striped cotton mini and flat leather sandals adorned with shells. Simple silver hoops and bangles completed the outfit, and the quick shake out of her natural curls, a dash of mascara, and a swipe of pure plum lipstick completed the look. She grabbed her pouch, checked for her ID, debit card, and cell phone, and after a quick internal discussion, decided to leave her digital camera in the room. 5 minutes later, and Kennedy was glad she'd taken Hank's advice. The shower had revived her, and now a warm breeze caressed her clean skin. The azure blue sky had slid into indigo. Stars twinkled and disappeared as she joined tourists and natives strolling down the paved pathway. As she reached the steps leading to the restaurant, on a hill, she paused, pulled out her cell phone, and captured the moment. Once inside, she was quickly seated on the establishment's veranda, where a row of seats faced the ocean. She ordered the seafood dish Hank had recommended and took the server's suggestion for a fruity white wine. While eating, she became engrossed with the latest news on social media, DMing friends and posting pictures of the island taken with her cell phone. So much so that she didn't notice a handsome stranger who had been seated beside her until he spoke.
I hate eating alone,
he began without greeting, while looking out on the waves gently crashing against the shore.
But if I have to do it, having a gorgeous woman beside me makes it infinitely more satisfying.
Only then did he turn toward her with a smile.
Well, damn.
Kennedy was prepared to be aggravated at the tired line, but the man was gorgeous in a way that was free and unscripted, a face that suggested, I woke up like this.
Thank you.
I was thinking about ordering that dish.
Is it good?
It's delicious. The concierge recommended it, and he was spot on.
Where are you staying?
Kennedy told him.
How have I missed seeing you?
You're staying there too?
For the past week, though mostly I've been down at the beach soaking up the sun. What are you doing here, if I may ask? And more importantly,
Why are you eating alone?
Kennedy turned and swept her arm across the occupied tables. I'm not alone. The stranger smiled, revealing pearly whites that sparkled just like his eyes. The color of the sky in her earlier photographs, the brilliant shade of blue against tan skin combined with a thick head of curly brunette hair. And Kennedy once again considered ending her penis drought. A server arrived, set down a drink, and took the man's order. Afterwards, he held out his hand.
Jack Sutton.
She picked up a linen napkin and wiped her hands. Kennedy waved.
Nice meeting you, Kennedy.
Likewise. For the next 40 minutes, the two casually chatted. Kennedy learned that Jack was an engineer from Rhode Island, recently divorced, taking his first vacation in more than 3 years. He was intelligent and funny, easy to talk to, and seemed to genuinely listen as Kennedy talked. When he suggested they split a dessert, she agreed. When he offered to pay the tab, she said yes to that too. When he asked her to join him for an after-dinner drink back at the hotel, Jack was 3 for 3. They sat in the cushy chairs of the lounge in the lobby and swapped tall travel tales. A yawn reminded Kennedy of the next day's early rising. She finished her decaf caramel coffee and reached for her bag. Thanks for a great evening. The dinner and the conversation. I enjoyed it.
Are you leaving?
Yes, she said and stood.
Then so am I.
Jack also stood and reached for his wallet. Oh, no. You did dinner. I've got this one.
Are you sure? I can't talk you into extending the evening. The company is amazing, and it's a beautiful night.
I agree on both counts. But tomorrow's alarm rings early. I have a plane to catch. They bantered back and forth a bit more, but Kennedy wouldn't change her mind. After paying the tab, the two walked to the elevator and got in. Jack's finger hovered over the floor buttons.
Which one?
7. He pushed 7 for her floor and 10 for his. Later, when asked, that would be the last thing she remembered that night. Chapter 2. Bright sun streamed into Kennedy's room. She stretched, turned her head, and blinked her eyes against its incessant beam. She sat straight up and immediately regretted the quick action. Granted, she wasn't much of a drinker, but she'd only had the rum punch and last night's glass of wine. Why was there a hammer in her head? Then, another question popped up between the banging. What time is it? Her mind screamed these questions, but her body refused to perform with the urgency belied by these words. Kennedy closed her eyes, blindly reaching for the cell phone while easing her head to the pillow. Feeling only the nightstand's bamboo top, she gave her head the slightest turn and took in the table with one eye opened. No phone. Dear God, do I have to move again? Kennedy perched herself up on an elbow and eyed the clock. The digital display confirmed what the sun had announced. It was mid-morning. She'd missed her flight. As that misfortune sank in, 2 observations slammed into her so hard her stomach clenched. 1, the ever-present cell phone she'd groped for wasn't on the nightstand. 2, she was naked. She never slept naked. Ever. Even after having sex, she'd at least put her panties back on. A slow sense of dread began to ooze through her body, like poison sludge invading the pure waters of peace that yesterday's boat trip created. She forced herself out of bed, wincing against the relentless throbbing. She pulled the light throw from the foot of the bed and wrapped it around her, dazed as she walked around and took in her surroundings. The clothes strewn across the sofa,
her small purse open, its contents spilled over her cushions, the laptop from which last night she'd sent off files and uploaded pictures gone, along with the digital camera she'd left beside it. Her cell phone nowhere to be found. Images flashed through her mind, blurry, disjointed. A soft, easy smile, deep blue eyes, dark, curly tresses, manicured hands, steaming cup lifted to tempting lips. Jack? The palms of her hands lifted to her forehead. Kennedy slowly massaged it, trying to bring the snippets of what she remembered from last night into one cohesive picture. She opened her mouth. To speak? To ask the empty room, the air, what happened? Only then did she notice how dry her mouth was, and the aftertaste of something acidic or acrid at the back of her tongue. Definitely not the taste of last night's coffee. Had she been drugged and then assaulted? The mere thought made her heart drop. She clutched her Kegel muscles. There was no soreness, and given it had been months since she'd had sex, there would be. Still, she wouldn't take a shower. Doing so could wash away potential evidence. She'd watched enough crime TV to know that. Will was heavily endowed. Maybe Jack wasn't. Maybe it wasn't Jack. What if it was someone else? Why couldn't she remember what happened? Couldn't have been just the wine. It had to have been something stronger, like a date rape drug. The throbbing returned full force. Her wallet lay open on top of the purse. Kennedy snatched it up. The clear pocket that should have held her driver's license was empty. Credit cards, debit cards, even her grocery store reward cards, gone. But the $25 from the ATM she'd taken out for tips was still there? WTH. To take charge cards but leave the cash made no sense at all. Anger at being ripped off spurred her into action. The faster this crime got reported, the better chance police would have to catch whoever violated her room. Maybe her body. Definitely her trust. Instinctively, she headed down toward the nightstand to grab her phone. That led to a growl of frustration and quick strides to where last night's clothes had been tossed on the couch. She dressed in seconds, then headed downstairs without thought for a card key. The elevator doors had barely opened when she shot through them and strode straight for the front desk. She met bright eyes and cheery smiles with a statement that quickly shifted the mood. I need the police. I've been robbed. The reaction was shock, not only from those behind the counter, but from the couple beside her who just checked in. Not a great public service announcement. Kennedy hadn't even noticed them there. Her focus was direct and singular. Police, investigation, rape kit, justice, now. Miss Wade, I'm so sorry. The woman, seeming barely a girl, really, spoke from her heart with her hands to her chest. Where were you coming from? My room. That's where it happened. A woman appeared from the office behind them. Her stride strong, her back straight, she bypassed the counter and walked directly to Kennedy.
Excuse me, miss. I'm Darlene Gardner, the front desk manager. I overheard your statement. Can you please come with me into the office?
Her voice was no nonsense, but her eyes were kind. She turned and headed back that way without waiting for an answer. Kennedy followed her, and for the first time noticed other guests in the lobby, and Hank's face, creased and troubled, staring at her from across the room. He'd recommended the restaurant where she'd met Jack. Was he in on what happened? Had it been smiling, friendly Hank who removed her clothes and took her belongings? The woman who'd come for her quietly closed the door.
Please, sit down.
I don't have time to sit. Somebody robbed me, maybe even raped me. I went out last night for a simple dinner and drinks and woke up this morning with no electronics, wearing no clothes, and having no memory of what happened.
I'm deeply sorry, the woman continued, unruffled, her voice low and calm. But before I can help you, and believe me, I want to, and I will, I need to hear the whole story to know who to call.
Who else do you call when someone's been robbed, except the police? For all I know, the perpetrator could still be somewhere in the hotel. I need law enforcement now.
A short stare, a brief nod, and then,
very well. But I am the front desk supervisor, and having no idea what took place, I don't have the authority to make that call. The hotel manager...
Kennedy jumped up and headed for the door. I'm not waiting for permission to report a crime. I'll use a payphone. I'll walk to the station if I have to. Please, don't leave.
Kennedy turned, her hand on the doorknob, to see the supervisor standing too. A second of silence passed between them.
I don't know what you've been through, but I do know what it's like to be mistreated. I am only trying to be thorough. And experience has taught us that the more information we can document as quickly as possible, the greater the opportunity to capture details that might otherwise be forgotten and left out. I will get the hotel manager in here immediately, and we will call the authorities, all right? And while they're coming, if you please, I will begin a report on what happened. The sincerity and compassion in the supervisor's words brought a bit of calm to Kennedy's spirit and mistiness to her eyes.
Thank you. She walked back to the chair and sat.
Most certainly.
What is your name again?
A small smile slipped past the stalwart demeanor behind a navy suit and crisp white blouse.
Darlene Gardner. Give me a moment to contact the manager.
She picked up the phone and punched a few keys. Almost immediately, there was a tap on the office door before it opened, and an imposing man with a serious expression stepped inside.
Mr. Leonard, I was just ringing you.
He nodded at Darlene, but his eyes were on Kennedy.
Are you the guest claiming to have been assaulted?
I am the one who was definitely assaulted. There is no doubt.
Of course, forgive my choice of words.
He extended his hand. I'm Charles Leonard, the hotel manager.
Did someone phone you?
Darlene asked. I was crossing the lobby and was notified that we had an emergency. Have the police been called?
I was just phoning you to have that done.
Let's get them down here. Charles pointed toward the chair beside Kennedy.
May I?
Sure.
He sat down. Kennedy shifted her body toward him.
Is it possible for you to tell us what happened?
Kennedy was struck by the way he worded the question, his mild manner contrasting with his commanding presence and with Darlene's measured tone.
Honestly, I was hoping to wait for the police and avoid having to repeat myself.
Charles nodded.
We can do that.
No pushback, no rebuttal. Nothing about lines of command and protocol or time being relevant.
Kennedy's face remained neutral, but in that moment, Darlene became one not to trust.
The police arrived within minutes, a team, male and female, strictly business.
We'd like to speak with you privately,
the woman said. Once introductions were made.
I don't want to repeat this story,
Kennedy interjected, as the memory of waking up naked crossed her mind. The hotel wants me to give them a report too. Thinking back on what happened or might have happened is difficult.
We will provide details to them for what you tell us,
the woman, Stephanie, replied. She looked at Darlene.
May we use this office?
Charles and Darlene left. Stephanie sat in the seat Darlene had vacated. Her partner, Byron, remained standing, notepad in hand. Stephanie pulled out a small tape recorder.
We would like to tape this conversation for documentation. Do you give your consent?
Yes.
Okay. Kennedy, it is our understanding that a robbery occurred?
Kennedy nodded. Stephanie sat back in the chair.
When did this happen?
Sometime between midnight and this morning, I guess. The memories are fuzzy. I may have been drugged and assaulted. She couldn't bring herself to say raped again. The police exchanged a look.
Tell us what happened,
Stephanie said.
As best you can.
Kennedy briefly recounted what led to her visit, and then taking an extra day to enjoy the island. She told of the boat ride, going to dinner, meeting Jack, and sharing an aperitif in the hotel's lounge. I paid the bill, and we walked to the elevator. He asked for my floor. I told him. He pushed it. Then he pushed.
Kennedy stopped, closed her eyes.
9 or 10, I believe. And that's all I remember until waking up today, realizing that I missed my flight. And because of that, we'll also be a no-show at tonight's Fabulous Friday.
Stephanie's brow creased. She exchanged another look with Byron.
Fabulous Friday?
Never mind. Kennedy waved a dismissive hand. It's a small gathering of professional friends back in Chicago. One of their birthdays is today, so tonight is going to be a celebration of that, too.
Byron straightened and took a step toward her. What day is it, Ms. Wade?
What kind of question is that? It's Friday.
Concerned eyes stared back at her.
Isn't it?
No, Miss Wade,
Stephanie said softly.
It's Saturday.
The truth punched Kennedy in the gut. She'd been out cold for 2 nights.
Chapter 3.
Kennedy had lost over 30 hours that she'd never get back. At first, she blamed the hotel. Why hadn't the front desk called her? Why didn't housekeeping try to clean her room? Was no one aware that a guest who'd planned to check out on Friday was still there a day later? A quick investigation provided the answer. 2 days had been added to her stay, courtesy of a PayPal account with an IP address linked to a Baltic country. Law enforcement recorded the information. Said they'd investigate. Kennedy's thought? Good luck with that. A do not disturb sign was all it took to keep housekeeping out and everyone unaware of a crime. She spent the entire Saturday with hotel personnel and law enforcement trying to piece together what had happened. An hour of that was at a medical center where she'd been given a physical exam that showed no signs of vaginal trauma, as one might expect, had forced sex occurred. Still, they conducted a rape kit and had blood drawn in hopes of identifying what was used to drug her. She'd phoned the U.S. Embassy and met with a representative with information on continuing the case once back stateside. By the time she boarded her evening flight to return to Chicago, she'd been made glad twice. Delighted to arrive in the beautiful Bahamas, and happy as hell to be leaving. Returning home, she didn't have the luxury of dwelling on what had happened in the Bahamas. Freelancing was a constant hustle, and she had a mortgage. It wasn't supposed to be a struggle to pay it. That came courtesy of a man named Will and her own foolish action of believing a liar who said the condo would be a home they'd share. A call from the Bahamas on Monday morning helped her get back into the freelance flow. The rape kit results came in. She hadn't been sexually assaulted. That only left her to wonder how she ended up naked. Since there had been no physical violation, was it possible that in her drugged state, she'd removed her own clothes? As improbable as that seemed, it felt infinitely better than imagining that she'd been undressed, ogled, and groped by a stranger. The more she warmed up to this take on the story, the better she felt.
The week following the incident was a whirlwind of insurance claim filings, electronic store visits, freelance website scrolling, and nonstop work. Saturday was a day of catching up with the mundane, cleaning, laundry, and her standing mani-pedi appointment. She'd also shopped for a birthday gift, a peace offering she hoped would make up for missing her best friend Gwen's birthday, even though her absence couldn't be helped. That night, she went to bed early and was up at 7 the next morning for a morning jog to the coffee shop. She bought dark roast Java, a bagel, and the Chicago Star. Super critical of her own work, Kennedy gave herself a pat on this one. She felt the article accurately captured what made the Bahamas such a popular destination. The pictures backed up those words. No time to rest on her laurels, though. She spent the rest of the day scouring various websites for jobs. By that evening, Kennedy was more than ready to meet up with Logan, a former coworker who Kennedy loved like a brother, and her bestie, Gwen. She entered Leftovers, the unofficial new hangout of the city's cool crowd. It was just after 7. The restaurant and bar had a full house, but she weaved her way through the suits and stilettos toward the booth where her friend sat. Along the way, she waved at a few familiar faces and realized it was the first time since the incident in the Caribbean that she wasn't subconsciously searching for a suspect. "Hey, guys." Kennedy reached Logan first. He stood and gave her a hug.
"Hey, you.
How you doing, girl?" Kennedy sat next to Gwen and leaned over for a squeeze, then held out the peace offering, hidden within a glittery gift bag. "Happy birthday."
"Thank you,"
Gwen replied, accepting the gift even as she leaned forward, her voice low and accusatory.
"Why didn't you tell anybody that you were robbed?"
Kennedy cut her eyes at Logan.
"I did tell anybody, and obviously anybody told somebody else."
"I wasn't supposed to tell anyone?"
He covered his mouth.
"Oops."
"Never mind that," said the woman to the person she thought was her best friend,
Gwen mumbled before asking, "What happened?"
"It's a long story, one that will go down better with drinks. But first, open your present."
Gwen's frown flipped as she removed the multicolored tissue papers from the bag and placed them beside her. Her eyes gleamed as she reached in and pulled out a CD box set, and when she saw the cover, she squealed,
"Aretha! You know that's my girl!"
She threw her arms around Kennedy's neck and gave her an exuberant hug, then sat back and flipped over the box. It's supposed to be a complete set of all the songs she recorded on Atlantic Records.
"Who?"
Logan asked.
"Aretha,"
Gwen intoned. "And if you ask for a last name, I'll cut you." The table cracked up.
"Everybody knows Aretha Franklin,"
Logan said.
"We've sampled her a couple times when creating beats."
"And paid her, I hope."
"Of course,"
Logan replied, with a hand over his heart as if wounded.
"Well, whatever it wasn't enough. How are you going to capture all of what she delivered in a loop?"
"Come on down to the studio sometime and I'll show you."
Gwen rolled her eyes.
"Her grandmother worshipped Aretha's talent,"
Kennedy said to Logan, hoping to ward off an argument. Logan's hip-hop obsession and music producer aspirations were as strong as Gwen's love for old-school R&B. Gwen grew up to her music. Plus, I think she's an old soul. The waiter came around. They ordered drinks.
"Thanks again,"
Gwen said, before placing the box back in the gift bag and setting the bag near the wall.
"I can't wait to play them.
With this amazing gift, plus knowing what happened in the Bahamas, you are forgiven for being MIA on my special day. I'm just glad to see that you're all right." Whether that was true or not was not up to debate. But Kennedy let the comment slide. She wanted to be all right. Maybe if she kept hearing she was, she'd believe it.
I read the article,
Gwen continued. It was fabulous. Made me want to go online and buy a ticket right then.
Thank you.
Those pictures were stunning. That rainbow? Wow. Was it photoshopped?
No.
But I can understand why you'd say that. I adjusted the lighting to bring out the depth of color, but it was even more amazing than what you saw in the paper.
The way you framed it, with the greenery from that island in the middle of the picture, the white sand and that sparkling blue water, very well done, girl.
I hope it leads to steadier work. That's my goal. Gwen looked at Logan.
Did you see the article?
I'm reading it now,
Logan said, cell phone in hand.
Can we talk about your trip at all, or is the whole island experience off limits until you get drunk?
Give me a break, Gwendolyn McPherson. Nobody said anything about getting drunk.
Did you get drunk in the Bahamas?
Logan asked.
Because if you did, you probably got some. You told everybody about the newspaper spread, but I know the real reason you went down there was to forget about Will.
Would you get out of my bedroom?
Kennedy asked. And worry about who's between your sheets.
I'm trying to get between yours.
Logan backed up his audacious statement with an unapologetic stare.
Whatever, little boy.
Yeah, you won't be saying that after I drop the boxes.
Gwen began an exaggerated bout of coughing.
Time out, time out.
Kennedy agreed. Logan was handsome. She'd give him that. And the kind of man she liked. Tall, lanky, coffee-colored with a generous splash of cream, and sporting just the right amount of facial hair. But he'd just turned 23. Even though Will was 5 years older than her 28 bald drops, Kennedy felt she'd spent 2 years babysitting a child. Next round, she wanted a grown-ass man.
So how was your time on the island? Gwen asked. Did you like it as much as we did Jamaica?
It's hard to compare them. Jamaica was a vacation. The Bahamas was work.
I saw some of your social media posts.
Logan said,
that boat ride didn't look like work to me.
You posted pics on social media too?
Gwen reached for her cell phone, tapped the screen, and began to scroll.
Not the ones that accompanied the article.
Gwen kept scrolling. The server returned with their drinks.
Who is this in the selfie pic? He's kind of cute.
His name is Clinton. He worked for the boat rental company.
These are nice,
but you definitely saved the best ones for the star. Gwen put down her phone. All right, enough shop talk. Let's toast to Kennedy arriving safely back home. They'd barely finished clinking glasses and getting through half a sip before she added,
now tell us what happened. How'd you get robbed?
Honestly, I don't know. She told Gwen the same basic story that she'd shared with Logan, the one that omitted being naked when she woke up. Even with not being sexually assaulted, she was still too embarrassed to share that part of the story. After wrapping up the police interview at the hotel, the manager and supervisor were brought back in and informed of what happened. We found out that there was no Jack Sutton registered at the hotel. No one at the front desk remembered anyone resembling the man I'd described. I'd become friendly with a guy named Hank, the concierge. He talked to absolutely everybody who walked either in or out of that lobby. He hadn't seen him either.
Or so he said.
Why do you say it like that? Do you think he had something to do with it?
I don't know what to think. After finding my stuff gone from the room, everyone became a suspect. But in my gut, I think it was the man who called himself Jack. I think he's an asshole who takes vacations and preys on women and steals stuff.
Logan nodded. I think you're right.
The fact that he lied about being a guest says it all.
So what happens now? Gwen asked. I wait to hear from my attorney.
Gwen made a face. Are you talking about Craig?
Kennedy laughed.
Gwen hadn't liked Kennedy's attorney ever since he had turned down an alcohol-induced invitation to join Gwen for a private party in her bedroom.
No, a Bahamian attorney. After the police left the hotel, I contacted the U.S. Embassy. Fortunately, a duty officer is available 24/7. He met with me and provided a ton of valuable information.
Like what?
Logan asked. He gave me an overview of how their criminal process operates. He had shortcuts to reporting my credit cards and driver's license stolen.
What about your passport?
Safe, fortunately. It was in a zippered compartment of my luggage, which was unlocked. But it didn't look like he rifled through it much.
Clothes don't sell as well as phones and laptops.
Spoken like an authority, Logan.
Girl, shut up.
Gwen ignored him.
Is that how you found your attorney? Yes. He had a list of several attorneys. I chose one who dealt primarily with my type of crime.
How much faith do you have in the police conducting a thorough investigation? Or in this attorney prosecuting the case if they find out Jack's real name or whoever did it?
Kennedy shrugged. The attorney was actually out of the country, so I only spoke with him by phone briefly a few days ago. The police seemed concerned, focused on the details of what happened and finding out who did it. They searched the room. I think they dusted for prints and stuff. Blood was drawn to find out what was used to drug me. But I don't hold out much hope for them finding evidence that could lead to him.
They probably collected dust balls. Evidence of how long it's been since you had sex.
Ha!
Kennedy gave Gwen a shove. You have no sense at all.
I feel as though I did everything I could do. Now it's time for the authorities and the Bahamian attorney to do what they do. Thank goodness I have a habit of uploading everything to the cloud, especially my pictures, as soon as I finish a shoot, and that I sent the article in before heading out to dinner. It could lead to steadier work from the star in the future, so having to rewrite it would have been a huge blow.
Gwen's brow raised. I think the blow is that whoever was in your room has your ID, which means they have your address and date of birth. Identity theft is a nightmare. Be sure and stay on top of your credit reports. No telling what they might try to do as you.
Kennedy sighed, shaking her head slightly as she reached for her wine glass.
I know. She took a long sip. They have my full name and date of birth. But I've used an alternative address on driver's license, checks, utilities, and stuff like that ever since reading this book that was written by the owner of a security company. So if they try and track me down, they'll find themselves driving into a strip mall and parking in front of mail, etc.
I know that's right. Gwen and Kennedy high-fived.
Not that I think Jack, or whatever his name is, will do that. He's probably more of a snatch-grab-and-go type of guy. Plus, he'd have to spend money to come after me, and since he's stealing, he obviously doesn't have much of that. As for the phone, it was shut off immediately. That was a laptop used strictly for travel and work, so there wasn't any extremely personal or confidential information on it. Like I said, I've done everything I can do.
Kennedy spotted a former colleague at the bar, a quirky Jewish guy with an encyclopedic memory and a wry sense of humor. She waved him over to join them at the table. He was the perfect solution to ending talk about work and burglaries. The four decided to stay for dinner, and afterwards went to an IMAX theater to catch the latest action flick. It was after midnight when Kennedy slipped the key into her condo lock, humming the song she'd just heard in her car. She stopped, though, when the steady beeps on her security system that signaled an open door didn't go off. Her heart seized for a second, but just as quickly she threw off the notion that something was wrong. This wasn't the Bahamas. It was Chicago. She'd lived there for a decade, and dating Will was the closest she'd come to having a crime committed against her. Can't believe I didn't set it, she murmured, sliding the leather strap of her laptop bag off her shoulder and stopping just inside the door to take off her shoes. One would think that after what happened last weekend, she'd double and triple check locks and systems. She said it, then picked up her heels by the straps and walked through the foyer and down the hallway. Reaching for the dimmer knob, she turned it and increased the lighting in the modern open concept area, then continued into the room. The living space was fine, but her office, visible from where she now stood, was not the way she'd left it. Drawers were open. Papers from her desktop littered the floor. Her home computer, the one that did contain personal and confidential information, gone. Trembling, Kennedy backed out of the room, then out of her home, dialing 911. Chapter 4. Kennedy felt drained, robotic, as she walked the officer to the door. It was almost 4 a.m. The police had taken almost 2 hours to respond. Is there going to be an investigation of this? She asked him.
We'll file the report, but honestly, not likely. Unfortunately, there are so many crimes more violent and egregious that we simply don't have the manpower to follow up on simple burglary claims.
So, if I'd been murdered during the burglary, there would be resources available to try and catch the culprit. The officer looked her dead in the eye.
Yes.
Thanks for being honest with me. The officer placed a compassionate hand on Kennedy's shoulder.
I'm sorry. There has been a spate of random smash-and-grab burglaries in the surrounding area. We have beefed up patrol, but without an eyewitness or concrete evidence to work with, that's about all we can do.
Kennedy closed the door and briefly leaned against it. She closed her eyes, feeling drained, mentally, physically, and emotionally. Footsteps echoed on the hardwood floor and neared her. Logan had been her second call after the police. Firm hands gently pulled her away from the wall. Strong arms wrapped themselves around her. The dam of strength that had kept Kennedy cool, calm, and collected from what happened in the Bahamas until now began to crumble. She laid her head against Logan's chest and allowed the tears to flow.
It's okay,
he cooed, rubbing her back as he walked them back into the living room.
I got you, Kennedy. We'll get through this, do you hear me?
Kennedy nodded. She pulled away from him and sat on the couch, her knees pulled to her chest. Logan pulled a tissue from a holder on the coffee table and held it out. She took it and blew her nose.
I just don't understand. Does lightning strike twice? Do I have rob me on my forehead? What is going on?
Logan slowly shook his head.
Oh, no. It does seem pretty weird, though. But you get robbed in the Bahamas 1 week and then get robbed at home just a week later?
He looked at her, his eyes conveying the churning taking place in his mind.
Do you think they're related?
I don't know what to think.
It appears that, once again, only electronics were taken, this time my desktop. My laptop was in the car from earlier when I decided to do work from the coffee shop near Leftovers. It's not like I live in an exclusive neighborhood, so why was my house targeted? Did they see me leave and know that the place was empty? I just don't get it. Nothing logical makes sense, yet thinking this is mere coincidence seems illogical and unlikely.
I agree.
The two remained quiet, lost in their individual thoughts about a possible explanation for what had happened to Kennedy, not once, but twice.
Kennedy.
Logan's voice was low as his eyes pierced her. What?
Do you think it was Will?
She shook her head.
Will is a lot of things, but a burglar?
I can't see it. I also can't think of why he'd want my desktop. He's a gamer and has a top-of-the-line system. No, I don't think it's Will.
What if it wasn't about the computer? What if you wanted to do something to interfere with your career? In the Bahamas, most of what was stolen had to do with your work. Camera, computer, cell phone. Last night, same thing. Work-related stuff. Maybe he's getting back at what you did to him personally by trying to sabotage your professional career.
Kennedy shifted her legs and sat up, her back against the sofa.
It's what he did to me that ended our relationship. I was always the one giving, compromising, sacrificing.
She shook her head. I don't think it's him.
What about another ex?
Kennedy pondered the question.
I can't see anyone I've dated wanting my computers. Maybe it was random, and I'm just having a streak of bad luck.
The officer did say burglaries have increased in the neighborhood.
Yeah, and I had no idea.
What about a colleague? Can you think of somebody who might be angry that you got a job they thought they should have? Or have it out for you for professional reasons?
Right now, I'm too wiped out to think at all.
I hear you. It's late. Why don't you go lie down?
You've been up all night, too.
Logan's lips took a slight upturn.
No, that's not an invitation.
His smile widened.
Will you be okay driving home?
I'm good. Will you be okay here alone?
We're about to find out.
Kennedy walked Logan to the door. When he turned to embrace her, she welcomed it. Independent and self-contained, Kennedy never felt she had the luxury of a shoulder to lean on or depending on a man. But given what she'd been through yet again, it felt good to be in the grasp of a man's strong arms.
Call me later, all right?
Okay. Thanks again, Lo. I appreciate you.
Kennedy crawled into bed. She took tossing and turning to a new level, but managed to catch a few winks amid the chaos in her mind. When she woke up around 2 o'clock, she roused herself out of bed. While taking a long, hot shower, she pondered the Bahamas break-in, last night's burglary, what it all meant, and what she was going to do to stop the madness. One thing she wanted to do, but knew she couldn't, was to call her mom. Carolyn Wade would be on the next thing smoking to Chicago, waving a one-way ticket for Kennedy's return home. She hadn't been a fan of her moving there in the first place.
Nothing in big cities but big trouble, she told her.
Kennedy and her brother Carl had experienced the ease and relative security of growing up in the small Kansas town of Peyton, where her mother had been born and still resided, along with Kennedy's grandmother and much of the extended family. Carl had gone to UMKC and lived in Kansas City, Missouri's largest city. They were two of the few who'd flown the coop and returned home only to visit, never to stay. Even though it wasn't yet 5 o'clock, she did call Gwen. Her normally flippant friend remained quiet as Kennedy relayed last night's events. Not even a joke when Kennedy said she'd called Logan and he'd come over and stayed through the night. Instead, the sincere comment when Kennedy went silent.
I'm scared for you.
She'd voiced the words Kennedy hadn't dared. She was frightened too. After talking to Gwen, Kennedy tried to put the burglary behind her by focusing on photos. The Bahamas spread in Sunday's paper had generated more interest in her work. She sent digital portfolios in response to 2 email inquiries on her availability and fee, one for an organic farms marketing campaign and website, and a very promising one from the Chi-Towns Convention and Visitors Bureau. Securing a position with the latter organization could mean steady work for years. She also sent a resume to a new regional publication seeking an art director. After finishing up emails,
checking social media and freelance sites. She filled out another Apple insurance claim and fully expected to receive a phone call from a representative suspecting fraud. If two burglaries hadn't happened to her in less than 2 weeks, she wouldn't have believed it either. Midway through filling out the online claim, the doorbell rang. Probably Gwen. Kennedy opened the door. Not Gwen. Logan, hey, what are you doing back here?
Taking care of business. Can I come in?
Sure. Kennedy stepped back and watched Logan's long...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.